Forget frequently asked questions.
Common sense, common knowledge, or Google.
How about advice from a real genius? 95% of people in any profession are good enough to be qualified and licensed. 5%
go above and beyond.
They become very good at what they do, but only
0.1%.
are real geniuses. Richard Jacobs has made it his life's mission to find them for you. He hunts down and interviews geniuses in every field. Sleep science, cancer, stem cells, ketogenic diets, and more. Here come the geniuses. This is the Finding Genius Podcast
with Richard Jacobs. Hello, this is Richard Jacobs with the Finding Genius Podcast. I have Sarah Ennis. She's a professor of genomics at the University of Southampton. She's worked in the field of genetic epidemiology for over 20 years. She runs the Human Genome Informatics Group. It's a dry laboratory, which we'll get into very briefly, specializing in the analysis of what's called NGS data and clinical cohorts. So we'll talk about all that. Sarah, thanks for coming.
No problem.
Yeah, I didn't know this until recently, but I've heard about dry labs versus wet labs. Can you explain that to listeners, what the difference is?
Yeah, I think this goes to most of the time when you tell people you're a scientist, they assume that you wear a white lab coat and you work in a wet laboratory with lots of beakers and conical flasks and small solutions and PCR machines and things like that. But increasingly, especially these days, more and more scientific research uses huge amounts of data. So actually, we're all scientists, but we look like, well, we're just sitting at computers, very often manipulating data, analyzing data, merging data together, using things like artificial intelligence, machine learning, statistics, to try and find out new information from lots of different types of data and merging different data types. And people who do that and sit in front of computers and analyze data are generally called dry lab scientists.
A wet lab is more traditional experimentation with
chemicals. More traditional, absolutely. People who might be doing models of gene function, might be analyzing people's DNA, might be trying to put mutations into different cell lines to try and assess their impact. They might be growing different materials. They might be trying to understand where different genes or proteins are expressed, where proteins are inside cells. So they'd be doing that sort of things using more traditional wet lab equipment, as opposed to the dry lab scientists who are using lots of different types of tools and software, but generally through a computer.
Okay. And then your work in particular, you're looking at the human genome. In what context?
So I've been looking at human genetic data for, as you say, over 20 years now. But principally, I'm looking at people who are sick, so patient data. So we've been, when I started working in this area, we were trying to find out sometimes how and why DNA mutates and changes. And how and why any of those changes that do occur, how do they cause disease? Why do they cause some people to be ill? And then why do other changes have apparently no impact whatsoever? So all of my working life, I've really been looking at either patient data or patient data and comparing it to people with, to healthy individuals, to try and understand what mutations are important in clinical disease. How they're important, why they're important, and trying to understand what happens in families with regards to those mutations. And of course, ultimately, the aim is to try and make it so having that extra information is of some clinical utility to try and help diagnose patients better. So providing clinicians and clinical research teams with more information, a more of an armory to inform themselves and understand how and why a disease comes about and what drugs might work best or what treatments might work best and what is the likely prognosis for those patients. So we're always trying to understand the clinical basis and inform the clinical outcomes for those patients.
Well, how do you know what you're looking at? I mean, I know you've been doing it 20 years, but what do you see? You don't just see endless strings of base pairs with the letters.
Well, actually, our data can look really, really, really boring. And there are actually some copies of the human genome reference sequence available. I can promise it would send even the worst insomniac to sleep. So it is literally 3 billion base pairs of A, T, Gs, and Cs. But absolutely, the question is, how do you know what you're looking at? So the sort of data we're looking at most frequently these days is called next generation sequencing data. And that's just a fancy term to say that we've gotten a lot better at sequencing human DNA. And actually for that fact, it's sequencing human, animal, viral DNA. So right now all around the world, there's lots of people sequencing lots of COVID samples. So we're much better able to sequence DNA and RNA of any source. And what we do is, for example, in a patient with disease X, we sequence their DNA, and it might be just for a specific section of the genome. For example, you might decide you want to look at a patient with cystic fibrosis, and you sequence the gene involved in cystic fibrosis, and you compare that patient who perhaps might have the disease of cystic fibrosis, you compare their sequence to what we now know to be the human genome reference sequence. And it's essentially a spot the difference sort of scenario, whereby you're finding the differences in the patient compared to people who don't have that disease. And then you're moving on to try and understand, well, why would changing a C to a G at that position cause disease? So you have to understand the context of any changes you find. So is it an important base pair with regards to helping that gene be switched on or switched off, or helping it be located at the right position within a cell so that it's able to do its job? Or does the mutation change the function somehow, mean that it can't interact the way with other the way it's supposed to with other proteins? So once we find those differences, we need to try and understand them. To be honest, one of the big problems is when we do the spot the difference thing between anybody and the human genome reference sequence, the problem is we spot lots and lots and lots and lots of differences. So problem number one is identifying, well, which differences are important. And then once we find those differences, it's trying more and more to understand exactly how and why they're important, and how that information might help us pass on new information to clinicians to perhaps prescribe the treatment that will work best in that individual patient.
You know that a certain sequence is a what's termed to be a gene. Is it always preceded by, let's say, I guess they call it a start codon, and ended by an end codon? Does it always fit neatly within two defined markers, or can genes sometimes be like nebulous?
Well, we certainly always used to think that. We always used to think genes were the most important unit. And of course, genes, or what we refer to as coding genes, are the bits, the recipes within our genome that tell us how to make all the most important proteins, whether those are proteins involved in making our eye cells receive light and help us to process images, or whether they're genes involved in liver function and help make enzymes that help us, break down paracetamol so that we can get rid of the pain in our leg after we break a leg, whatever it is. So those genes are very, very, very important. But more and more, we're understanding that there's other units throughout the genome that are not traditional genes, as we call them, with a start site, an AUG codon, and a stop codon. So there's lots of other non-coding genes that don't actually end up coding for protein, but they do get transcribed. So they do print out a message, but it's a message of RNA rather than DNA. And that RNA message does have a function within the cell. Very often these are regulatory functions, and they can be really, really important too. So whereas our image of genes and the regions of the genome that encoded important messages has been quite limited, the more we learn about the genome, the more complex it gets. And the very simplified analogies that we might have had maybe 30 or 40 years ago are always getting more and more complicated.
When I imagine DNA being read, I imagine, you know, a part of it unzipping and part of it being read. If I say, I don't know, you have a left strand and a right strand, or strand one and strand two, is strand one always red, or is certain spots strand two red, for instance?
Oh, yeah. So we call those the positive and the negative strand. So the positive strand runs what we call 5' to 3'. That's just to do with the way the chemicals are at the start and the end of the strand. So the positive strand is the strand that we often refer to as the reference sequence strand. But it's a really good question you ask, because in fact, it's not the only strand that codes for either coding for genes that either code for proteins, or the ones that don't, that they just code RNAs. Both strands can actually code for genes. So it's entirely possible that you would have one gene being encoded on the positive strand, but also on part of the same complementary negative strand, you can have an entirely different gene be encoded.
And I've heard there's DNA also can loop and lasso and, I guess, bring parts of itself together and be read. Is that
yeah?
That?
Yeah.
So can you read part of a gene on, I don't know, the you know, one of the strands and finish it on another strand from another place?
So individual genes are more often coded contiguously, or the exons for individual genes can be coded contiguously within a gene section. But there can be regulatory genes that either could be on the opposite strand, or could be further upstream or downstream on the same strand of DNA, or be on a completely different chromosome. And it's the can be the complex of those genes and the RNA transcribed from those genes that actually is involved in the ultimate functioning of that section of DNA. So very often DNA does rely, and the ultimate expression of DNA does rely on more messages than just the message in that specific region or gene.
So when someone says they've sequenced, you know, a particular creature, or they've done a particular sequence, are they just talking about the positive strand from start to finish, or
yeah.
Do you sequence the negative strand too? Do you sequence, I mean, how do you sequence properly?
Okay, so you do often hear that scientists have just sequenced the first copy of some new species, I don't know, the armadillo genome. And what they typically will have done at that point is get a small number of samples from that species. And certainly when it came to the human genome, they divvied it up and shared different chromosomes out amongst labs around the world. And a small number of samples will actually be sequenced. So a small number of individuals might be sequenced. And then a consensus will be reached. Typically, people read out the sequence on the positive strand, because DNA always has this complementary base pairing rule, that if you have an A on one strand, you have a T on the other strand. If you have a G on one strand, you have a C on the opposite strand. So this ATGC base pair ruling means that if you read the positive strand, by default, you will know the negative strand. So it tends to be when somebody publishes a sequence, they tend to publish the positive strand. So that's what's encoded, or what's then made available as the reference sequence for that species. But of course, what's actually made available for the reference sequence might actually be made up of some number of different individuals. For example, the chromosome 1, 2, and 3 could be from individual A, and 4, 5, and 6 could be from individual B. And there are some issues with that, because of course, then you're what truly is reference? Who represents, for example, the normal human that should be the reference human genome sequence? And the truth is, there is no normal human. We're all different, and many individuals live happy, healthy lives to up to their hundreds. So there's no one individual that represents the normal or the best reference human genome sequence. So what people tend to do is, as the versions of the genome reference sequence have evolved over time, and we're at version 39 at the moment, very, very rare mutations that might have been found in those original individuals that have been sequenced, they've been replaced with what is more commonly observed in most people. And that's what's now evolving to be the human genome reference sequence. But of course, there'll be key differences between ethnic groups. And so it may be over time that we might generate a reference human sequence for Northwest Europeans and another one for maybe different African populations or Asian populations. And then those specific references might be the best references depending on which patient group you're looking at or what your scientific question is.
So how different would your genome and mine be versus two sisters, let's say?
Okay, so it depends. It depends exactly. So I can't see you right now, Richard, but I'm not sure exactly what your
group are. I am human.
You're human, thank you. You're human and you're speaking. So it'll depend. If we were from very different ethnic groups, then our DNA will be slightly more different. Whereas if we shared two parents, then we would expect that 50% of our genome would be in common. So that's why we're able to pick up relatives from, crime databases and that sort of thing. Because if, for example, somebody got sequenced or had certain amounts of their DNA looked at or their DNA fingerprint looked at, it might be possible then if somebody else was, involved in for some reason having their DNA looked at some years later, it's possible to pick up relatives that way, because first degree relatives or siblings will share on average about 50% of their DNA, because they will each have received half of their DNA from their mom and half of their DNA from their dad, assuming they have the same parents.
The percent, I thought it would be like 99.8 versus 99.9, let's say.
Well, the amount that you receive that's identical. So every time a woman generates an egg cell, a gamete, half of her chromosomes, so we're a diploid species, so we have two chromosome number ones, two chromosome number twos, all the way up to chromosome 22, and they have an X and a Y. And in one of those egg cells, the woman will just randomly put one of her chromosome ones, one of her chromosome twos, one of her chromosome threes, all the way up to the sex chromosome. So 22 individual chromosomes, and then one of her X chromosomes will go in there. And let's say one of those egg cells went to make me, whereas then my mother might have made another egg cell to make my brother. It will be a random allocation of those 22 chromosomes plus the sex chromosomes that goes into the egg cell that makes my brother. So each time you're sort of flipping a coin to decide which of the chromosomes goes in. So of course, along the genome, those chromosomes might be very, very different. Even if my brother and I inherited two different chromosome ones from our mum, all along the chromosome one, everybody has almost exactly the same sequence. Everybody who's human will have almost exactly the same sequence of genes, and the vast majority of the coding region of those genes will be very, very similar amongst all humans. But by chance, there's a 50-50 percent chance that I would share exactly the same copy, mutations included, as my brother for each gene across that chromosome.
Wait, so when someone's sequenced, which set of chromosomes are you sequencing on them?
Well, actually, that's another good question. You sequence across the whole region and you find out every point at which there is a mutation. And sometimes the mutation is only on one chromosome, and sometimes the mutation can be on both chromosomes. So you find out that information too. So, and that's called a genotype. When you're not finding out, so it's kind of like you have two versions of every gene, and you've got to find out what are the combined set of mutations or changes or variation across the gene and the genome that any individual has. So sometimes for whatever it could be, position 100 in gene X, it could be that I have a C in the copy of that gene I got from my mum, but I have a T in the copy of that gene that I got from my dad. So I would be called a heterozygote at position 100 in that gene.
So what happens if, the end goal is a certain protein is produced by a section of my genome that is heterozygous. How do I respond versus someone that's homozygous or they don't have that at all?
Okay. So that all feeds into the whole reason why some people at worst and some genes and some diseases are known as dominant and recessive. So if you take cystic fibrosis, for example, so that's a gene involved in a channel that has a role in clearance of mucus from the lungs. And if you have a mutation in that gene, and remember, we all have two copies of that gene. In order to have the disease, you need to have both copies of that gene compromised. So that would mean that the copy you got from your mom must have had some mutation in it that impaired its function. And the copy you got from your dad also had a mutation in it or a variant in it that caused it to work less, the same protein to work less well, or perhaps not to be copied out from the DNA at all. So, and it's not always essential, actually, that you inherit the same nasty variant from your mum as the nasty variant you inherit from your dad. It could be that in the copy you get from your mum, there's a deletion at the start of the gene that means that the gene recipe isn't read properly. And in the copy you get from your dad, perhaps part of the stop codon isn't working. So you end up printing out some gibberish with the gene as well. And that copy doesn't work either. But ultimately, it means that the individual who inherited no good working copies of that gene would suffer from cystic fibrosis. Whereas perhaps that individual's brother or sister might have inherited the copy of the mutated version of from their mum plus a normal copy from their dad. And for that disease, for cystic fibrosis, because it's a recessive disease, you don't actually present with any symptoms unless both copies are compromised. And so that's known as a recessive disease. But there, of course, are, unfortunately, a number of dominant diseases as well. And that means that even if only one copy is impaired, it's possible to present with the clinical symptoms of that disease. And that changes from one disease to the next.
So do you ever characterize families like, you know, so my mom's chromosomes are, I don't know, do you ever label them as like up and down, you know, like the first pair are labeled all up, the second pair are labeled all down. So I'm like one up, two down, three down, four down, five up. Do you ever, I'm just making up my own language for it, but
yeah, yeah.
Characterize people like that?
Well, we very often, when we're looking, we wouldn't characterize individuals like that, but we would perhaps if we had lots of sequencing data on an individual, obviously, we need a format for encoding those data in very, very large files on a computer. And so very often the data would be encoded. For example, you would to encode any variant or to capture the information about any one variant. Typically, you would have which chromosome is the variant on, what position on that chromosome is the variant at, and that's the position according to the reference map. And then you would list what we would expect to be at that position. So you might expect to see an A at that position because that's what's seen on reference at that position. And then you say what you observe at that position in your patient. And it may be that you observe, well, in the genetic sequencing data that you've got for that patient, you have 50% of your data for that patient says that there's an A there, but the other 50% of the data says there's a T there. So that looks like that individual is a heterozygote at that position in that gene. And we would encode that either 1/0 or 0/1. And perhaps some other individual might have, all the information might indicate that they have T at that position. So that position would be a homozygote for the non-reference allele, and we would encode that 1/1 at that position, noting down the fact that the change was from an A to a T. So rather than the up-down, we do use ones and noughts.
Okay, I got you. So when you talked about next generation sequencing, what is that versus the sequencing that came before it?
So the first generation sequencing was a type of sequencing called Sanger sequencing, and it's very clever, very rigorous method of sequencing genes, and it worked absolutely well, and it's been regarded as the gold standard in sequencing for generations and for decades. The problem with it was that it was very expensive to do a huge amount of sequencing that way, mainly because it was a little bit slow relative to what we can do now. So groundbreaking and phenomenal as it was at the time, new methods have come along that allow us to sequence, basically to sequence DNA at a much, much higher speed. And that's called next generation sequencing. And it allows us, where it took about a decade to sequence the human genome using old-fashioned Sanger sequencing, well, it's now possible using next-generation sequencing to take DNA from an individual, be it a blood sample or a saliva sample, and you extract the DNA, and it's actually possible to generate a whole human genome sequence in little over a day now, at a absolute minute fraction of the cost of what it was to generate the first human genome reference sequence. And that is what next generation sequencing. It's the newer technology that allows us to sequence at huge scale, which means that we can take, in my area of research, we can take individual patients and actually sequence vast amounts of their genes to try and work out what variations they have and which ones of those might be important in their disease and in helping us understand how people have acquired or been born with some problem. So we can better understand it and better work out how to fix it.
Is the whole genome sequenced or just parts of it?
The vast majority of the sequence of the human genome has been sequenced. There's these really tricky bits.
All right, so you were saying, I was going to ask you, so is the entire human genome sequenced? Because you keep saying we're sequencing a large part of it.
Yeah. So, in actual fact, we do know the vast majority of the whole human genome sequence. There are these little regions around what's called the centromere of individual chromosomes. So we have these 23 pairs of chromosomes in humans, and each chromosome has this sort of central core region that's important when making gametes, when making egg cells and sperm cells. And that particular region, it's called the centromere. It doesn't have lots of genes in it, but it does have some very, very sticky DNA. And by sticky DNA, we often mean quite repetitive DNA. So regions with very, very long or very high GC content and repeated sections of G's and C's. And it can be very tricky to actually stop the DNA tangling up on itself to get an exact read of what those G's and C's are. So at the moment, that's not perfectly resolved, but it's probably also balanced out by the fact that we don't expect there's an enormous amount of genes in there, so we don't think we're missing very much. But those regions are likely to be quite different from one person to the next, but they're also just terribly sticky, and so we haven't got a perfect sequence around that region. But almost all the rest of the genome, we have really quite good sequence of, and we'll have sequenced all the other regions of the genome in many, many, many millions of individuals.
So how have people figured out, you know, this stretch of base pairs is this gene? How do people define genes, and how do they know what they do?
So to define a gene, well, there's computer algorithms now that can go through sequence data, very much like machine learning algorithms could go through sequence data now and pick up the key signatures of genes. So start positions and stop codons and splice site regions, which are regions that of the genome that end up kind of highlighting a position where a molecular scissors has to come along so you can stitch together all the correct sections of a gene. So it's possible to train machine learning algorithms to do that now because we have found so many different genes. We know a lot of key characteristics. That's not to say that there isn't some stuff that we're still overlooking because we've still yet to learn about it. But both genes that code for proteins and genes that code for important RNA regulatory molecules, many of the key characteristics of those are known. So we're able to predict those from the genome, the genetic code. And of course, once we know the structure of a gene, well, then it's actually possible to clone it perhaps into some cells in a laboratory and generate the proteins from those genes. And then we can do, well, this is back to the traditional wet lab functional testing of how those proteins interact. Do they bind properly with other proteins that they're expected to interact with, even when they have some variants or mutations at a position? So that's how we then start to take changes in the genome and test the function of the proteins that those genes encoded.
Overlap for a certain stretch, you know, gene X, does it only do one thing, or do some genes do multiple things?
Well, some genes do lots and lots of different jobs. Very often, the detail available on genes is always based on what we first identify as the function of the gene. But the more and more we study different genes, we're seeing that, okay, we thought that gene just did something in the liver, but actually now we understand it also does something in the kidney. So very, very often genes actually have more than one role. But the first time the gene is studied, obviously its role is very often named for what it's first found to function as. But it's probably wise just to say, well, okay, we know it does that, but we don't know what else it does quite yet. So increasingly, we're finding additional roles for genes that we assumed, once we found out one of its roles, we assumed that was its role. But it's like everything in biology, the more you look at it, the more complicated and the bigger the puzzle gets and the more layers that puzzle has. So there's lots of genes that encode proteins, whereby we're seeing that the proteins can have subtly different functions in different tissues, or there can be subtly different versions of the gene that are produced from a single gene. It's kind of like, I always think of it as, if you can have a recipe book, and the recipe book could tell you how to make a sponge cake. But some genes, just like that, they tell you how to make the sponge cake. But there can be some additions to it that tell you, well, okay, this is how you make a chocolate sponge, and this is how you make a lemon sponge, and this is how you do a vanilla one. It's possible to do the same thing with genes, that there's subtly different versions of different enzymes and proteins that may have different functions at different stages of our life. So, for example, some genes, they would have a particular flavor, if you like, encoded or produce a particular flavor protein during the in utero life, when a baby is just growing in its mother's tummy. But the same gene might switch on an extra little bit of that gene, or add a little bit of extra of the recipe during adult life. And so it's a slightly different protein coded then, but it does perhaps a similar function, or it could still function, have multiple functions around different tissues in the body.
Genetics, methylation, histone deacetylation. How do you sequence if something is methylated or it's affected epigenetically?
Okay, so standard next generation sequencing approaches typically just work out the ATD base pair sequence, but there are newer technologies called third generation sequencing technologies that at the same time as sequencing the ATGCs, sometimes those are chemically able to work out if there are methylation signals or other chemical modifications to those base pairs. So it can be possible to do that. It's also more expensive to do, and it's not part of the standard approaches that are being used in very, very large scale projects such as All of Us or Genomics England.
Are you able to sequence the epigenetic marks on someone's DNA, or is that not there yet?
Well, if you use some of these newer third generation sequencing technologies, there are some studies showing that they are generating good data, which does show these chemical modifications such as methylation. So some of the third generation sequencing technologies can do that. They can work out the epigenetic changes. But to do that on a genome-wide scale would be very, very expensive and still somewhat prohibitive. So people tend to zoom in on particular areas of the genome that they're very interested in, and then they might sequence those areas using this third generation sequencing technology and work out what the methylation or what other epigenetic applications are to that sequence. So it is possible, and I've no doubt it will become increasingly possible and increasingly more accurate.
Have people looked at sequencing different cells from that person, different cell types, to see if there's any differences?
Yeah. So there's a huge project called the Human Cell Atlas that's sequencing cells from different parts of the whole body. So we have lots of different tissues, and there are lots of projects going ahead, just sequencing different cells from different parts of the body, and sequencing the RNA from different parts of the body as well, to try and understand what changes might be seen in those particular tissues. And of course, one tissue type that people are very, very interested in sequencing is tumor tissue. So there's an enormous application of next generation sequencing in taking small biopsy samples from patients who have a cancer, a tumor, and sequencing the tumor and comparing that to the other healthy cells in that individual. And again, doing the sort of spot the difference, where does the tumor differ compared to the normal healthy cells within that individual, trying to understand those changes and then targeting the cancer treatment specifically towards the mutations that are observed in the cancer cells only.
For when you look at data from someone, like, you know, what's an example, some of the things that you're looking for?
Oh gosh. So because we run a genomics lab, we actually can end up doing projects on lots of different clinical situations. So my laboratory looks at common diseases, rare diseases, and cancer. So we're looking at some rare cancers, trying to understand what are the genetic variations in those cancers that bring about the cancers and make them perhaps more aggressive or less aggressive. We're looking at rare diseases. So rare diseases are diseases that affect typically less than 1 in 3,000 patients and are very often caused by mutations in just one gene. And again, it might be on both those individuals' copies of their genes, so the copy they got from their mum and the copy they got from their dad, or it might be just a single gene mutation in one copy, a dominant disease. So we try and understand rare diseases, both dominant and recessive. And my group is also very interested in looking at what's been traditionally labeled complex diseases. So those are diseases like asthma, rheumatoid arthritis, type 2 diabetes, inflammatory bowel disease, and trying to understand. So in those diseases, we know that there's lots of different genes that can either cause, sometimes by themselves or sometimes working together with other genes and perhaps even with environmental triggers, to bring about disease. And those are called complex diseases, or sometimes referred to as common diseases, because they do tend to be a little bit more common in the population. So we end up looking at the entire range of human clinical presentation, whereby we think that genetic changes may be influencing somebody's susceptibility to develop a disease.
So, okay, we're getting close to the end, but what projects are you working on right now? Are there any particular ones, or it's whatever is, you know, are there certain diseases you're looking at, or what's your focus?
So we have a number of projects ongoing at the moment. I work on a particular project looking at initially it was restricted to children, but we've opened it out to adults as well who have been diagnosed with inflammatory bowel disease. So that's an autoimmune disease of the gastrointestinal tract, and it's a nasty disease, especially in children, because it means if your gastrointestinal tract is not working when you're young and trying to grow, it means that children may be very unwell and not able to take in their nutrition and grow as they should and be able to get to school. So it can be a really nasty. So we've been looking at that. We've recruited lots of children from around our region. And we've also, because it's a genetic study, we recruit their mums and dads. And then we've also started recruiting adults from our regional hospital as well. And we're sequencing lots of those individuals to try and understand on a case-by-case basis what might be the molecular basis of disease in each of those children. Because even though they might all present with very similar symptoms, it can be quite a different molecular cause. So it can be two very different genes causing the disease in individuals who present with almost identical clinical symptoms. And we think it could be really important if we're able to work that out, to be able to tell the clinician, okay, that it's actually gene X or a combination of gene X and gene Y in your first patient, but in your second patient, actually, it's a totally different gene altogether. and a different drug might be useful there. So we're trying to understand that better. And of course, it's an autoimmune disease. So some of what we find out there will be relevant, not just for inflammatory bowel disease, but for a number of the other autoimmune diseases. We're also working on a number of cancer projects, specifically some cancers that are not commonly looked at in Genomics England or some of the bigger projects. So we're looking at some peritoneal cancers in the gut, and we're looking at some different rare lymphoma cancers. And then in rare disease, I have some really strong collaborations with some pediatric nephrologists and ophthalmologists at the University of Southampton and at the University Hospital in Southampton. And so we tend to look at patients presenting with clinical symptoms in those clinical disease as well.
What do you think is going to be possible from your work and from our understanding of DNA and of genes over the next few years? And then what do you think is way out in the future still?
Well, I think over the next few years, and what's really coming in now is the ability to actually get a diagnosis for everybody, and not just a diagnosis as in a category that sort of labels a patient's presentation, but actually a molecular diagnosis that pinpoints the specific DNA changes that have meant that an individual has presented or developed a disease. And that makes it might sound like a subtle difference, but for some people, not understanding what the disease is or why it's there can be very difficult. And of course, understanding the molecular basis of all diseases, whether they're common or rare, is a critical first step in order to be able to prescribe the correct drugs that will actually have some effect in those individuals. So I think genetics and genetic diagnosis is going to be playing an increasing role in all our healthcare over the coming years. And I think it should help us diagnose things earlier and identify the best medicines and personalize the medicine, the medicines that are made available to individuals once you know what their molecular disease is. And I think that's increasingly become part of the norm in both in the hospital setting, in the tertiary care setting, and then gradually perhaps even shift into primary care setting.
Well, very good. What's the best way for people to find out more and get in contact and see the work that you're doing?
Well, we have a website at Southampton, and I'm at the Faculty of Medicine in Southampton, and we have a website there that details our ongoing research. And of course, anytime we get some new and interesting information, we always try and publish it in scientific journals and make that available. So anybody who has any specific interest in any areas that I talked about could have a look at those papers or find me online.
Well, very good, Sarah. Thanks for coming. I appreciate it.
That's no problem. Thanks very much, Richard.
You've been listening to the Finding Genius podcast with Richard Jacobs. If you like what you hear, be sure to review and subscribe to the Finding Genius podcast on iTunes or wherever you listen to podcasts. And want to be smarter than everybody else? Become a premium member at findinggeniuspodcast.com. This podcast is for information only. No advice of any kind is being given. Any action you take or don't take as a result of listening is your sole responsibility. Consult professionals when advice is needed.